just talk about a lesson from Jesus on stewardship. A lesson from Jesus on stewardship. Now, is there anybody in here that do not understand the term stewardship? If you don't know what the word stewardship means, raise your hand. Well, the word stewardship, it means that you have been given possession of something that is not yours. It means that someone has entrusted you with something and made you the overseer of that something that does not belong to you, and that you are obligated to the person who gave you the responsibility to do the right thing with that they have entrusted you. Which means that if you are a child of God, you are a steward of God. It means that everything that you have in your possession is not yours. Your house is not yours. Your resources are not yours. Even your children ultimately belong to God before the foundation of the world. And so God gives us all these things, and he wants us to be good stewards of that he has given us. And at some point, he's going to come and ask us to give an account of our stewardship. One of the greatest statements on stewardship that I ever heard is in the book of Job, where Job said when they told him that everything he had been destroyed and existed no longer. The greatest stewardship message in all the Bible was Job, who looked upon those who told him that bad news. He said, "Naked I came out of my mother's womb, and naked I shall return." In other words, he understood clearly that his Job, that when he came here, he did not have a wife. When he came here, he did not have children. When he came here, he was not living in a four-bedroom house. Am I right about it, somebody? And I want you to relate this to yourself, because I want you to know that when you came here the same way. You didn't bring anything here when you came. And if you think you own it, if you really think it's yours, try to take it with you when you leave. I have never seen a U-Haul behind a hearse. Am I right about it? When you did, everything that you thought was yours, along with the refrigerator and the washing machine, is going to belong to somebody else. And not only if you don't believe it, you just stay a little while and then wait, because the Bible says that we are encamped about with so crowd of witnesses, which means that I believe that when you die, when you're a child of God, you can see some things. And when you die, just look down on your house. Just for a little while. I know you, see, when you get to heaven, you ain't gonna worry about that stuff, but I just want you, if you can remember this when you pass away, look down there and see the Negroes fighting over your clothes. And see old Hattie, Auntie Hattie talking about, she said that was gonna be mine. Uncle Henry and them gang, you know. And so we don't own anything. That we are stewards. I mean, we are stewards. And the reason why I picked this message is because this message is not a message that typically I would pitch. I mean, as a matter of fact, I don't know any preacher that really wants to preach from this text, because it's strange. Because there's a steward here, And it is puzzling because this steward is a crook. I mean, there ain't no question about it. This guy is a crook. This steward in this story was a crook before I read the story. He was a crook while I was reading the story. And he's a crook in the middle of the story. And he's a crook at the end of the story. And you would have thought that Jesus would have pulled him under the rug and just say, hey, man, what are you trying to do here? You would not think that Jesus would have given this person accommodation. And the disciples were listening because they knew that Jesus was going to say, look at this bad steward. But instead, the master approved of some of his shenanigans. I mean, this was a smooth operator. Am I right about it? Not only was he a smooth operator, but he operated quickly, man. He said, oh, God, I'm not going to have a job. I'm too old to dig. I got to figure out a way to make sure I'm going to be all right when this thing is over. And then he started giving his master stuff away in order to take care of himself. This man was after number one and taking care of number one and number one only. And Jesus says, this man is smart. Jesus says, this man is smart, for the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. That means the children of God. That they are wiser. That this man showed wisdom. And so I thought I'd just stop here because this story is so strange. That see, can we get something out of it that can help us be better stewards? And the first lesson that I see that Jesus is trying to teach us here is that this man, he was able to secure his future. And maybe what we have here is Jesus pointing out the fact that this man was wise enough to secure his future and understood in order to secure his future, it took money. Yes, sir. Because when you talk to the average Christian said, well, it ain't about money. As a matter of fact, right now, I'm talking stewardship and doing this whole sermon. There's going to be people sitting there under their breath talking about it ain't all about money. But yet Jesus is commending this man because he understood the value of money as it related to securing his future. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And what I'm trying to get you to understand is that your money, although it's not all that important, it is important for you to securing of your future. That's right. Amen, lights. I mean, what you do with your money dictates the kind of future you're going to have. I wish somebody here would say amen. I wish you'd say it again. I mean, if you don't believe me, all you got to do is turn to Matthew 6:19-21, where you hear Jesus himself saying, don't lay up for yourself treasures on the earth, where moth and rust destroys and thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth can corrupt or rust can destroy, and neither thieves cannot break in. And then he says this in that 21st verse of that Matthew 6. Yes. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And so now you can say what you want to say, but I say follow the money. Amen, lights. Matter of fact, there's another thing I tell you. It may be old, but we should remember it. Show me the money. Amen, lights. I mean, folk talking about they love God. They love the church. Show me the money. Because Jesus says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Your heart is never going to be where your treasure is not. Amen. You want to know what's important to people around here? Hire a private investigator and find out where they're spending most of their money. And you'll know what's more important to them. Amen, lights. Amen, lights. You want to know how important something is to a person? Just find out where they're putting their money. Amen, lights. Go to the racetrack. Go over to Atlantic City. Go, no, don't go to Atlantic City. Go down there on Delaware Avenue, Columbia Boulevard. And I'm glad I'm a pastor, amen. I'm glad I pastor in Philadelphia, too, because if I was a gambler, I couldn't go there because I'd run into half my congregation. Amen, life. Friend of mine said, take me down there. I said, no, you got to go down there by yourself. Ain't no telling who I'm going to see up in there. Amen, life. And I'd hate to see one of our old sisters there with a coin and with a cup in her hand and pulling a thing. I'd hate to see that. I don't know, dude, I don't want to see that. Amen. You know, I'm on Facebook and I'm seeing more than I want to see on Facebook. Y'all need to fix your Facebooks up a little bit better. You can't be a child of God and have a picture of a negligee sitting up on a chair, winking. Don't y'all know what y'all putting on them things? Lord Jesus, mercy. And you're telling people where you're going. I'm on my way down to get the lottery ticket. I think it may hit the big one. Just writing it all down. Jesus said, well, your treasure. So the first lesson is simply this. You've got to understand that your wealth, that what God has given you in terms of your stewardship, it can secure a great future for you. Yes. Yes, second lesson we have here, and I'm going to be brief here because I want to not do damage to myself. But the second lesson we see here is that Jesus says in verse 9, and I say unto you, make to yourselves friends of men of unrighteousness. Now, I want you to now not focus on the friend piece. I'll get to that, but I want you to focus on what he calls it, manner of unrighteousness. That's what Jesus calls money. That we possess, that we love, that we cherish. That when Jesus talks about it, he calls it manner of unrighteousness. That is important to us, that many men and women will kill for and die for and spit on people for and fight for and scrape for. Jesus calls that precious item of ours manner of unrighteousness. And the reason why he calls it that is because there would be no need for money if it had not been for sin. Adam and Eve didn't have to buy anything. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Adam and Eve didn't have to go to a grocery store. Adam and Eve didn't have to go to a shopping market. Everything was in their possession. Everything they needed, everything they wanted, God had already provided for them. But now we have to work for manna of unrighteousness because of sin by the sweat of our brow. That's what you're doing. That's what you're doing. You are earning the manner of unrighteousness by the sweat of your brow because of sin. So you need to know that you hold dear is not important to God. Are you hearing what I'm trying to say? There's some people who think there's nothing more important, but for the Lord, it's a little thing. Hallelujah. It's a little thing. It's so little that that's how he characterizes it here. He talks about that it's so little that you're going to get greater stuff if you're faithful with the little thing. Oh, God. Money. In God's sight is simply a medium of exchange. And how you use that money wisely, it will secure your future. Yes, sir. Lesson one, use money to secure your future, Jesus says. Yes, sir. Lesson two, don't make a god out of it. It is unrighteous manner. It entered into the world because of sin. Third lesson. He says that it can make you friends. That in Luke 16 and 9, he says it can make friends for yourself. Now, what friends are he talking about? He's talking about those individuals that may be saved because of your securing your future by investing your resources in the kingdom of God. Do you really understand what I just said to you?
Yes.
What I'm saying to you is for those of you who have made commitments to give over and above the call of duty in order to get the gospel out as I'm preaching right now, the world can tune in to me. There will be people that will be saved and will die and go to heaven who you do not know right now. But glory be to God, when you die and go to heaven, them folk will know that your money helped them hear the gospel, and they'll be waving at you when you come in. Somebody here ought to say amen. And I get excited about that, that every time I invest in evangelism, every time I invest in my church, every time I'm faithful in my tithes, I am gaining friends in heaven. When I get to heaven, there'll be a crowd waving at me, saying, there's a man who invested in me. There's the man who invested his resources in me. Lesson number one, lesson number two, lesson number three, you make friends because you're involved in what I call kingdom building. And that's what stewardship is all about. Don't fool yourself. That's really what it's all about. It's about kingdom building. It's about putting your treasure where your heart is, that if you love the Lord, if you love the church, if you understand the movement of the church, if you understand that Jesus said to the church, go ye into all the world and teach all nations, if you understand that we have to go, that we have a mandate to the world. I've instructed the officers of our church and our administrators to change our logo, that we might have a global perspective on who we are.
Yeah.
And so our logo now, if you notice it, it is a cross. And that cross is in the center of the city of Philadelphia. And then you have Greater Exodus underneath it. But our ministry is no longer cities. Our ministry now is global. Somebody ought to say something. There are people all over the world who are familiar with your faces, particularly those of you who get a shout in every now and then. And they know you because they see you.
Yes, sir.
And they see you because of your investment. And I want somebody right now to give God praise for what we're doing right now. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Somebody here ought to say amen. We are invested in the kingdom, and the kingdom is shifting as we invest. I wish somebody here would say something. I wish somebody, that the kingdom of God is expanding because of your gift. The kingdom of God is shifting because of your gift. At 3:00 today, because a young preacher that was called before the foundation of the world will preach his first sermon, the kingdom is going to shift. Oh, God. The kingdom is going to expand. Somebody here ought to say something. And so when we give our money, we give our money that the kingdom expands. We give our money that the kingdom continues to shift. We give our money that men and women might be saved. We give our money that men and women might know what we know. We give our money that men and women might go say, oh, taste and see. That the Lord is good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The fourth lesson in this passage is that Jesus is emphasizing the importance of being trustworthy. In that 10th verse, he talks about it. That if you want to be trusted, you've got to be a trusted person.
Yes, sir.
Am I right about it? In other words, what Jesus said, I can't give you life. I can't give you health. I can't give you strength. I can't give you a job. I can't put a roof over your house. I can't give you children. You don't even have enough love for me and trust in me to be faithful in your giving. You want me to trust you with great things. But I can't trust you with the little stuff that I give you. I mean, the big question really to be asked here is, can you be trusted? The big question to ask yourself sometimes is, can God trust me? And if I live my life in such a way that the Lord Jesus will say, I can trust that person. Does the Lord Jesus look at you and see faith? Or does he look at us and see fear? I mean, how much do you trust him? I mean, listen, let me tell you something, guys. Let's cut through all this. I mean, you can shout on every song and shout on every hoop, and we can have all this. But let me tell you something. The bottom line is, if he can't trust you with resources, he can't trust you. Amen. I mean, that's really what it boils down to. Can he trust you? Does he have faith in your faith? Does God have faith in your faith? If you say he does, then why don't you plant the seed? Why don't you quit making excuses why you can't do what it is that God has commanded you to do? Why is it that Sunday after Sunday you shout in disobedience? Why is it Sunday and then you'll use me as an excuse and somebody else you don't like as an excuse? You ain't giving to me. You're giving to the kingdom of God. I will not allow you to be my excuse. That's the reason why I don't count no money. That's why I write very few checks. Because I don't want you to ever use me as an excuse for not securing your own future in the kingdom of God. Plant the seed. You're going to reap what you sow. And the seed is not yours anyway. The seed belongs to God. And so you're only planting that that ain't yours no way. And then when you plant it, he promises you that you're going to reap what you sow. So if you're going to reap what you sow, then you ought to sow what you need. Anybody in here need some money? Well, then you got to sow money. Am I right about it? And if you sow in the wind money, you'll reap in the whirlwind money. Because you're going to reap more than you sow. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And not only are you going to reap more than you sow, you understand that you better be careful what you sow if you're going to reap more than you sow. Get your mouth off these deacons. Get your mouth off the choir. Get your mouth off the musician. And for God's sake, get your mouth off of me. Because 10,000 more tongues will come at you. Because you're going to reap more than you sow. Am I right about it? And don't think you say, well, ain't nothing ever happened to me. Let me tell you something. You reap later than you sow. Sooner or later, it's coming. Amen. I say, sooner or later, it's coming. If it's good, it's coming. If it's bad, it's coming. You are going to reap what you sow. You're going to reap more than you sow. You're going to reap later than you sow. Now, I want to just give a word to some of you faithful ones out there that have been sowing and you haven't seen a harvest. Just keep on sowing. I want to give a word to those of you who are trying to do the best you can. Just keep on trying to do the best you can. Do the best you can. Just keep, don't worry about it. You say, I'm sowing. You say, I may be crying sometimes. That's okay. Go on and cry. God will use your tears as irrigation to bring a great crop. Am I right about it, somebody? Am I right about it, somebody? Turn to your neighbor and say, keep on sowing. Keep on sowing. Don't let no street corner barbershop clipper Karen guy tell you anything about your church. Don't let no hairdressing grease-slapping beautician tell you something about your church. Turn to your neighbor and say, keep on sowing. Hallelujah. Soon the harvest will come. Soon the blessing will come. Soon. The fifth and final lesson from Jesus. Oh God. Jesus says in verse 13, he says, it's totally impossible to serve me and money. It's impossible for you to serve me and money. No man can serve two masters. He will either hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and he'll despise the other. You cannot serve God and money.